Starting in verse number 1, you should have found it. Say amen and stand to your feet to honor the reading of this portion of Scripture. Second Corinthians chapter number 4, starting in verse number 1, you'll find these words in the New Revised Standard Version. Therefore, since it is by God's mercy that we are engaged in this ministry, we do not lose heart. We have renounced the shameful things that one hides. We refuse to practice cunning or to falsify God's word. But by the open statement of truth, we commend ourselves to the conscience of everyone in the sight of God. And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. In their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. We do not proclaim ourselves, we proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your slaves for Jesus' sake. For it is God who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. But we have this treasure in clay jars, so that it may be made clear that this extraordinary power belongs to God and does not come from us. We are afflicted in every way, but not crushed. Perplexed, but not driven to despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Struck down, but not destroyed. Always carrying in the body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be made visible in our lives. For while we live, we are always being given up to death for Jesus' sake, so that the life of Jesus may be made visible in our mortal bodies. Verse 12. So death is at work in us, but life in you. We have this treasure in clay pots. I want to preach for about 20 minutes, I promise, from the subject, the testimony of a light bearer. The testimony of a light bearer. Let's go to God in prayer. Father, I am you all, but I know you talk. What I have, you give. What I am, Lord, you made. Lord, I'm depending on you. Can't do nothing till you come. This is your servant's prayer, asked in Jesus' name. And all God's children said, amen. Before you have a seat, turn to your neighbor and ask them, neighbor, are you a light bearer? Turn to us and ask somebody, neighbor, if you a light bearer, isn't enough to define who we are. We pursue things, we gather credentials, we gather stuff, and before long we have accumulated like a janitor with a ring of keys, a whole series of titles that we have. Titles come to define many of us. Titles come to say, to distinguish us from somebody else. Let me be clear, I'm not knocking titles. Because when I'm sick, I want somebody who has the title doctor to see me. When I'm on an airplane, I want someone that has the title pilot to fly where, to fly me where I'm going. When I need to file my taxes, I need somebody who has a title that suggests they understand the legal process. What I am saying, however, is that for many of us, titles have more importance and more significance than the titles that we really should claim. In other words, we grab titles that really don't define our essence, but those titles that really give us legacy, we leave aside. In other words, it's all right for folk to call you doctor, but the bigger title is one that they can call you a human being. It's good for folk to call you lawyer, but it's also good if folk can call you father, mother, brother, and sister. Are y'all there? Amen. Titles become important for us, and I want to tell you that today, as I read my text this week, I'm getting to understand that Paul was wrestling and wanting to present to a congregation a title that mattered to him. He wasn't caught up on the title apostle. He wasn't caught up for sure on the title saint. What he was caught up is on the title that he wore as a badge of courage. Let me explain the text and get on down and sit down. This second book of Corinthians comes to us from the pen of St. Paul. Paul wrote this letter because as the founding pastor of the church of Corinth, he had wrote them an earlier correspondence for them to get some things together. In 1 Corinthians, Paul wrote this church to let them know that word has come that there are schisms and cliques throughout your congregation. Can I pause here? It's a sad thing when churches get into cliques and schisms, and folk begin to compete for who's better than somebody else. Y'all better say amen, somebody. Paul said in the first book of Corinthians, I want y'all to get that stuff together. Paul was trying to right the wrongs of this church. They were caught up in so much foolishness that Paul wanted to get it right. They had immorality rampant in the congregation. They had folk fighting over who had the better spiritual gift. Paul wanted them to know the church ought to be different and better than that. So Paul wrote that letter. Paul let them know, I'm coming to see you. Paul did go to see them and talk to them and hope they got things together. Paul came back and found out they were still doing the same old foolishness. So then Paul wrote the book of 2 Corinthians. But this book wasn't so much about the schisms in the church, but there were a group of folk that came into the church that were causing confusion. If you're a Bible student, you would know this group. They were known as the Judaizers. They were individuals they came into the church seeking to get the ear of those in the membership. How did they do that? They began to talk about the founding pastor Paul like he was a dog that had three tails and two legs. They began to tell lies about Paul and begin to say that Paul wasn't authentic, that Paul wasn't genuine, that Paul wasn't for real, that Paul used trickery and fancy talk to deceive y'all. They began to say that Paul really didn't even have a letter of recommendation when he came. And if you listen to Paul, they would say, you are following the wrong stuff. Isn't it funny, church? How there are folk who believe the first lie somebody said about you.
What? Yeah.
late Dr. Romina Strickland, one of the first females to receive a PhD in New Testament from a Baptist seminary. This sister was my mentor. She was in her 70s when I started my undergraduate degree. She told the story one day to the class, and maybe I'm the only one that hadn't forgotten. She talked about this text, and she said that one morning she had to go to Fort Worth from the campus for a dental appointment, and she caught public transportation. She said, when I got on the bus made me stop. She said, I noticed at one stop there was a boy in a real fancy neighborhood outside of a nice house. He was in the front yard trying to put together a tent. She said, I remember how anxious he was, how happy he was. He was putting together a tent because perhaps that night he was going to lay out in the tent in the safety of his neighborhood and camp out. And he had all the joy and excitement of somebody who's trying to put the tent together. She said, I went